Nancy Baldwin, and welcome to the first, well, not annual, the inaugural radio play competition here, sponsored by Arts Richmond. This is in memory of Colin Skipp, a dear, dear friend of Arts Richmond and a Twickenham actor who played Tony Archer for 46 years. We are extremely pleased today to be hosted by the worshipful mayor of the London Borough of Richmond-upon-Thames, Cllr Geoff Acton, and I'm going to ask him to come up now, please.
Thank you very much, Nancy, and welcome to all here today. We don't normally do this in the parlour, but it seems to be working well, so I hope we all have a good afternoon, and as I say, you're all welcome here. And this is the first time this actual competition has been done, and it's good to see that we've got some very good entries, and I don't know anything about the winners. You've chosen all that.
No, so I've chosen no one.
Nobody, right. So we're looking forward to listening to the players in a minute. I would like to say my thanks to Arts Richmond for keeping going, really, during the pandemic, because they've done a lot of sterling work on keeping the communications going in that. I'm a member of one of the orchestras which are in it, and we've been keeping that dialogue going, so it's great. So, welcome again, and we look forward to listening to all the players. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Now, our next guest is somebody whose voice will be familiar. I'm very, very happy that Buffy Davis could join us here today. She's the voice of Jolene Archer and has been working with Colin for many years. And she's just going to say a few words for us. And then I would just like to mention that we also have here with us today Sir Vince and Lady Rachel Cable, who are the co-presidents of Arts Richmond, and they've joined us for this as well. But we'll start with Buffy, please.
Thank you, Nancy. So I am thrilled to be part of this. I came in late in the judging, and so I didn't read all the plays, but the ones I did were fantastic. So all of you out there who've written just great work. Just a few words about Colin. Colin and I worked with on the Archers for about 20 years. He would be so thrilled, because for Colin, story was the thing, and nobody could tell a story like Colin. He just had the best, longest, shortest, funniest, saddest stories going. So all of you who've written, he would be thrilled. So it's just for me to say, have a great afternoon and enjoy listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Buffy. So in order so that we don't actually give the game away, we're actually just listening to these plays in alphabetical order. So our first play, I should mention all of our finalists' name first. So we have Anna Burns, we have Patricia Camish, we have Annie Morris, and Carolyn Pertwee. And those are our four finalists. And we're going to start with Anna Burns. Anna, would you like to come up and tell us a little something about your play, please?
Thank you, Nancy. As Nancy said, my name's Anna Burns. I'm a freelance journalist and print media, and more recently radio, and a big lover of all things drama. And I first got the idea for doing this play just down the road, actually, at Hampton Open Air Pool. I quite often go there to do 40 or 50 lengths at a time. And while I'm swimming, I find that my mind kind of casts back over key moments in my life, things that I perhaps shouldn't have said, but more often than not, things that I really regret not saying. So I thought that would be a good premise for a radio drama. I hope you enjoy it. I certainly enjoyed making it. This is Swimming in the Rain.
Sorry, I can't talk right now. Please leave a message.
Hi, Nick. It's me. Long time no talk. I just wondered whether you could make it to Claire's birthday thing today. I'm not sure if you got my text, but it's at the Lido at 5 p.m. Let me know if you fancy it, or obviously I completely understand if you don't. But if you do, just come. You don't need to let me know or anything. Oh, it's Sophie, by the way, but you probably worked that one out already. Okay then, well, I hope everything's good with you. Okay, bye.
I might not me.
Well then, he'll have had a lucky escape, won't he?
What the hell, Sophie? What do you even
you
mean
really
by
don't
that?
Know me at all, do you?
How are you feeling, Sophie?
You're amazing, Sophie.
I feel...
When we're older, I'm going to come and find you and make sure you're married to someone amazing.
Say it, Sophie.
I feel...
You just can't say it, can you?
Sophie, don't you want to get me?
No, my sweetie's in a puddle.
We'll just give them a wash at home and then they'll be fine.
They're all muddy now.
Well, they are, but you could be muddier.
No, I want to go home.
Here, have my sweets.
Yes!
Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do.
What are you doing, Claire? Who are you being?
Jean Kelly.
Who's she?
He. Here, take my umbrella, twirl it like this.
Do, 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 do.
Now you're being Jean, I'll be Debbie Reynolds.
Who's Debbie Reynolds?
And tap your feet like this.
I can't, my belly's all big. I'm cold.
If you keep dancing, you'll keep warm.
Stop splashing! I don't like it!
Do.
Don't.
Yes, you do 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 do.
I'm going to get you. Flash!
Do 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 do.
I love watching the rainfall on the pool surface. Water studding water with ever-increasing sparkling circles. I know everyone loves a lido on a hot, sunny day, but give me rain every time. The water feels so much warmer under cloud and there's barely a soul about. To me, peace is a pool on a grey day.
Yeah, yeah, after the gala.
Or it would be without the idiot lifeguard.
Yeah, totally, mate. Yeah, like seriously, when she first came into the gym and asked if I could show her the equipment on offer, we both knew she wasn't talking treadmills, mate. Know what I mean?
He's here every morning, flaunting his six-pack at the poolside gym or talking loudly on his phone to some other fitness freak. He'd almost be good-looking if he wasn't such a tool. He's not the tallest of tools, mind. If I squint at him when he's on lifeguard duty, he looks like an overgrown toddler in a high chair. That thought keeps me amused while I'm counting off my lengths. But who am I kidding? This place holds too many memories for me to ever really be at peace.
Nick, over here. Sophie and I were just wondering whether to join the volleyball.
Well, you were.
Fancy it?
Sure. Could be a laugh, I suppose. Back in a minute.
I can see myself now as a teenager, a grudging spectator in dark sunglasses hiding under my hoodie, while the popular girls bounce around in their bikinis and I mutter sarky comments to Claire. Does Tanya even realise she's on show like that? She's practically popping out.
I think that's the whole point. Apparently it's a sweetheart plunge tankini.
There's nothing sweet about that. She could really do with some self-awareness.
Trust me, she's very aware of herself.
And that khaki colour. It's more tank than tankini.
Well, she's definitely on the attack. I never thought I'd say this, but poor Adam. So, Nick's cute.
Is he? I hadn't really noticed.
Uh-huh. Your face says differently, Soph. I like him. He doesn't seem to go in for that whole mindless lad act like the others. He seems different.
He is pretty cool, actually, from what I can make out. I mean, we haven't really talked yet, but we're in the same group for GCSE music, and he's, like, really good at the guitar.
Come and play volleyball with us.
God, no. I'd rather sit on the sidelines and make sarky remarks, thanks. Stick to your strengths and all that.
Okay, well, please yourself. I'm off to score.
Claire, he's, like, 5 years younger than you.
Not like that, sis.
35. Wow, they're still running ballet lessons in the poolside studio. I remember catching sight of my reflection at the bar one time, bang smack in the middle of what Mum called my puppy fat stage. There I was, a lump in a leotard. Ballet was supposed to be graceful and dainty. I knew that from watching the Nutcracker at Christmas. I knew that from watching Claire. Me wobbling through approximations of pliés and pirouettes bore no resemblance to the fancy French words our teacher called out each week. Jeté, chassé, glissé. They sounded light and delicate and sophisticated. I knew I was none of those things. Mum made me carry on for a while, but It wasn't long before I gave up on ballet completely. In the meantime, Claire's bedroom became a shrine of framed certificates of honour, while my paltry pile of past pluses gathered dust under the bed. To be honest, I wished I could hide away with them for most of the time. I heard how the other girls at school talked when they realised Claire and I were sisters. They were amazed that someone as confident and beautiful as her could be related to someone like me. I learned to be ready with one-liners when the put-downs inevitably came my way. But one time, one of the more annoying girls asked, "How come your sister is so fun and friendly and is always up for trying stuff, and you're like the total opposite?" I didn't have an answer for that.
That sounded great. Is it for the assignment?
Oh, hi. I didn't know anyone else had booked practice this evening. The booking sheet was empty, so...
I just came to collect my guitar from my locker. Sorry to interrupt. Please, carry on.
No, you're all right. I think the world can do without another Beatles / Carpenters ripoff.
It didn't sound that way to me.
It's called Yesterday.
Ah, well, titles are interchangeable. Yesterday, Yesterday Once More, Only Yesterday. Ooh. Carole King's Tapestry, good taste. She's got to be one of the most successful songwriters ever.
Yeah, I mean, there are all the greatest hits everyone knows are hers, like Natural Woman and You've Got a Friend.
But there's so much stuff that you wouldn't know was hers.
Exactly.
Up on the Roof.
Will You Love Me Tomorrow?
I'm Into Something Good.
The Locomotion.
The what? Get right out of town. Everyone knows Kylie wrote that. You know, a few of us in the class are thinking of starting a band if you ever fancied playing together. It'd be great if you were up for... trying some keys or some singing?
Oh, right. Thanks. But I'm not sure I've got what it takes to front a band.
Well, you could always try a bit of backing and see how you go. To be honest, there are quite a few egos already competing for the limelight of lead vocalist.
Oh, the breakup's going to be legendary.
You heard it here first.
Do you have a name?
Oh, sure. Sorry, I thought... it's Nick.
Oh, I meant the band. I know who you are.
Sure. Right, of course. Well, we've got a working title of working title.
I see what you did there.
Catchy, huh? Anyway, I'll let you get on. Sophie, right?
Right.
Nice to probably meet you, Sophie. See you in class.
See you.
And it's not like she's Scarlett Johansson or anything. I said to Brad, if you're gonna hit on someone, why go for the worst looking girl here? I think she might have heard me, actually. Yeah, I know. Awkward. I better go, man. The boss is eyeballing me.
Like I say, total tool. 48.
So I wanted to tell you about the weird night I had on Friday.
Oh yeah, the Varsity Social, right?
Right. It turns out there weren't actually that many people there I knew, apart from Adam and his rugby mates, and there was no way I was going to attempt to keep up with them. Your sister was there, though.
Oh, God, I bet she was in her element with all those burly sportsmen hitting on her.
She really held her own, actually. Adam started getting really loud and abusive. Your sister told him to ruck off, stop being such a flanker.
Rugby chat?
Rugby chat. So, I'm just going to come right out and say this. Would it be weird for you if I asked Claire out?
Like, out? On a date? No offence, Nick, but you're not really her type.
You'd be surprised.
What does that mean?
Well... we kind of kissed the other night.
Wow.
You're angry.
I'm not angry, I just... wow.
What are you thinking?
To be honest, Nick, pretty much all my other male friends have been there at some point. So in a way, it would be weirder if you didn't ask her out. Sorry, I'm not being fair. I just don't want to see you get hurt. She gets bored really quickly. I think her relationship record is 3 months or something. And then there's the age gap.
Well, don't worry about that. You never know, it might just be, you know... fun.
Please. My stunning, size zero, socialite sister. Fun.
You're right. She's out of my league.
You really like her, don't you?
Yeah. I think I do.
Then you should go for it. She'd be really lucky to go out with someone as lovely as you.
Thanks, Soph. That means a lot. Are you sure it won't be too weird for you, though? For us? I mean, you're practically like a sister to me.
Am I? Wow, a sister. That's something.
Oh, are you okay?
I'm fine. I'm just tired, that's all. Ignore me.
I won't ask her if you don't want me to. You're really special to me, you know? You're amazing, Soph. You know, when we're older,
I'm going to come and find you and make sure you're married to someone amazing.
Like me and my amazing man, what you hanging around are amazing. New York apartment, passing judgment, gooseberry.
Quite right. Nothing to do with me. I just, I'll always care, you know?
67.
Claire, are you all right in there?
I'm fine. I probably just need to sleep it off.
Is it something you ate, do you think?
I don't think so. It's the third time this week. I think I might be pregnant.
Oh, sis.
I feel different, you know? The peeing, the bloating, the unbelievable tiredness.
Do you want me to go and get a test for you? I've got time before I meet Tom.
No, it's fine. I'll go later.
Look, it's none of my business who you're seeing or not seeing, but I'm here if you want to talk about it, okay? I love you.
Soph?
Hmm?
It's Nick. Nick and I have... Oh, please don't look at me like that. I was going to talk to you about it, but I figured...
You figured what, Claire? That you just go behind my back?
It's not like that. Please, Soph, don't do this. Not again. It's not fair.
I'm not being fair. You're my sister, Claire. You could have anyone you wanted. Why does it have to be him?
Look, you've got to stop putting him on a pedestal like this. Tom might seem all laid back about it, but he's not. He was asking the other day if you and Nick had history. He's clearly getting a complex about it.
So now you're an expert on my boyfriend as well? I mean, are you planning to move in on him too?
What? Sophie, I would never...
Please, spare me.
Why does it have to be like this, Soph? It's like you don't want Nick, but you can't bear anyone else having him either.
Is that what you think? After all this time? You really don't know me at all, do you?
Well, maybe if you let me in once in a while, I feel
like... It's always about how you feel, isn't it, Claire? First, you felt like snogging him. Then you felt like dumping him. I pick up the pieces, then 5 years later, here we are again.
Well, go on then, Sophie. Tell me, how do you feel? You just can't say it, can you? Nick thinks that if you just talk more about...
Nick thinks? You know, you can be really patronising sometimes. I don't need you to tell me what he thinks, thank you very much. It's bad enough you both lying to me without being a post-coital discussion point. God, to think you might actually be a mother. What a joke. Have you even had a relationship that lasted longer than your lip gloss?
Look, I might not be pregnant, okay?
Well then, he'll have had a lucky escape, won't he?
Where are you going?
You might want to hang around playing happy families, but I'm out of here.
Last call for flight 507, boarding to New York.
Sophie, it's me.
Soph, it's Nick.
I know you don't want to talk right
now. I know I'm probably the last person you want to
see. I need to see you.
Before
we
get this.
I can't do this over the
Oh my God, are you okay? Let me get you out of the pool. Can you hear me? Deep breaths, okay? In, out, in, out. That's great. Let's get you warm. Just take your time. Are you okay?
I think so, thanks.
You're Claire's sister, aren't you?
I was, yeah.
I was so sorry to hear what happened. We all were. She was really great to work with. It was such a shock.
The last time I spoke to Claire, I was vile to her. She dropped a bombshell and I didn't know how to handle it, and I just went off, burying my head in the sand on some selfish soul-searching odyssey while she was facing her last days in hospital. I don't think I can ever forgive myself for that.
You weren't to know. I mean, she didn't know, did she? It all happened so quickly.
I didn't know you worked together. You know, today would have been Claire's 35th birthday. We're having a sort of celebration for her later up on the deck. You should come.
Thanks. I heard. Listen, I'm really sorry, but I've got to take a class in a minute. Are you going to be okay?
I should take this.
Try to remember the good stuff, you know?
This is the best New Year's Day tradition. I mean, singing in the rain is winter heaven anyway, right? But under the duvet when it's practically snowing outside?
I think that's hail, Soph.
Still?
You're in a good mood.
Do you still remember this routine? Oh, here comes the synchronised sofa sequence. You were always spot on at that. I could never get the arms right. Or the legs, come to think of it. You know, I always wished I could dance like you.
You can dance?
Depends on your definition.
You've got the rhythm, sis. I mean, I wish I could sing like you and play like you. Are you still writing your own stuff?
Not recently, no. I find it helps if I've got something I'm really riled about.
So you're not riled anymore then?
Nah. I'm sorry I was such a cow to you.
Well, I won't lie. It was tough being at the receiving end of your wrath. Cougar car crash, Soph. Really, I'm 29, for God's sake.
You'll be entering your fourth decade any month now, Claire.
Don't remind me. Soph, you know I wouldn't have gone there if I thought you were in any way interested, right? You always said that you and Nick weren't like that, so when he made the move, I figured...
What? He made the move on you?
You don't sound like someone who's not interested, Soph.
I've told you, we just look out for each other, that's all. He's like a brother to me, so it was just weird for a while, but it's fine now. I'm over it. Really.
Well, there's nothing to get over. I've decided I'm going to take a vow of celibacy for the rest of the year. I'm done with men.
Claire, it's January the 1st.
What are you saying, Soph? Don't think I can handle the spinster scene?
Wasn't it your New Year's resolution last year to find a husband?
Well, this is Claire Denison version 2016. All she needs is the sisterhood. Or just having her little sister back would be brilliant.
I give it a week, the spinster thing. The sister thing has an annoying habit of sticking.
Thanks, sis. Love you.
Tolerate you.
Ow! Get off!
Thank you very much, Anna. Now, one of the things about this competition that is quite challenging is that we only allowed our authors 15 minutes to tell their entire story. And that is a big challenge. So I want you to appreciate how difficult that is. Our next author is Patricia Camish, and she's going to tell us about her play, Finders Keepers. Come on up.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Patricia Camish, and I'm delighted to be here this afternoon, especially as this is my first attempt at writing a radio play. The story, I have written poems and been involved with Arts Richmond for some years, but this is my first play. The story involves Lucy and Tarn, two students, one of whom is a nurse, on a camping holiday in rural central France. I always love camping and it's a natural step. I also love the area of France, which I have described, and I hope perhaps that listeners will be intrigued by that, and also perhaps by the music I've used, which is very traditional, and although it's accordion music, it's accordion music, but not as we know it. Two girls find a wild and rugged spot where something quite unexpected happened. Unexpectedly also, I had to organise a recording of the play from France with the help of a friend in Kingston and with staff and students from Richmond upon Thames College, who were wonderful. The fact I was in France ensures that you will get real, authentic French sound effects, popping wine corks, rippling rivers, and birdsong. I do hope you enjoy the play, Finders Keepers.
Finders Keepers, a play by Patricia Camish.
Lucy, slow down! We must have taken the wrong turning. This track is awful.
It's fine, Tarn. Stop whinging. Look, there's a gateway. It's open and it's got a sign.
Thank goodness. I couldn't take it any more of all that bouncing around over those ruts.
Oh, stop moaning, Tarn. We found the campsite. It isn't far from the village at all. No distance. What was it called? Lanaway? Something like that?
Lanaquay.
Yeah, right. Well, in the village, that old deer in the boulangerie made it sound as if the river was miles away. What's the sign say?
It's very faded. Camping municipal La Riviere. Well, we were looking for somewhere quiet.
Near the river.
Perfect. Come on, let's get sorted. I can't resist the smell of that fresh bread in the back for much longer.
The place looks abandoned, it's very overgrown.
Oh, come on, let's have a look.
Well, we can see if there's anyone around.
There's a building over there. It might be an office or the loo block. Let's check it out first. I can't cope with these awful loos. You know, the squatty things.
Good idea. I'll come with you. At least the ground's softer than the place we were at yesterday. We might actually get some pegs in to fix the tent down tonight.
Well, who was it that said we don't have to peg down this sort of tent? It stays up by itself. It was fine in Glastonbury.
Okay, you win. Right as usual. How was I to know to blow a gale and chuck it down in the rain as soon as we'd got to the restaurant?
Well, I have done this sort of camping before. Mum and Dad used to take us every summer. God, they had so much stuff. We kids could hardly fit in the car on top of it all.
Sounds ghastly.
No, it was fun. Ages ago now. Mum and Dad loved camping. They even camped on their honeymoon. And after we kids had lost interest in family holidays. Right until Dad got too ill.
And now we're enjoying it. Come on, cheer up. Feel the freedom. Go where we want. Stop where we like. No lectures for you. No A&E night shifts for me. This looks great. Real wild camping. Better than that commercial place yesterday. All parasols and pizza.
But Luce, don't you think it's strange? No caravans, no tents, no reception.
Yeah, no barrier to get through, no screaming kids, no marked out bays with little hedges all around just like your auntie's back garden. What's not to like?
Here we are. And the door's ajar, but those notices are too faded. Let's have a look. Well, that's all working. Luce?
Luce? Over here. There's some sort of office all shut up. But they could be on a 4-hour lunch break. What are the loos like?
Not bad. Not squatties, at least. The wash basins are full of spiders, but apart from that...
Great. We've got the place all to ourselves, so we can pitch the tent wherever we like.
But it might be closed down.
Good grief, Tarn. Stop being so English. It'll be fine. We can park the car over there by the reeds and put the tent next to the river.
I suppose we could go into Llan y Cwe later and ask at the bar.
Sure, if that makes you happy. Now let's go and fetch the car. Ratio! Look, Tarn, our very own beach. What a sky. Perfect. Why is it never that blue in England?
Let's get this all organised. The sooner we get the tent up, the better, so we can dry it after last night. This time, we'll peg it down properly. And then food. Starving.
Oh, this is the life.
Funny no one's been to check the site.
Tarn, for goodness sake, stop stressing. You're driving me crazy. We've got it all to ourselves. Just enjoy it. If there's a problem, we can sort it out tomorrow. Come here and sit down. Relax. This bread is wonderful. And the cheese. Get some wine inside you.
Okay, sorry. Cheers.
Cheers. Here's to us. And that wonderful sun on the water. It's dazzling.
Luce, over there, across the river. Look, there's something floating. Just coming round the bend, over by the cliffs.
Looks like a log, but there's so much reflection, I can't really see.
No. It's a boat. There must be somewhere upstream where you can hide them. We did it once with Mum and Dad.
You're right. It is a boat, but I can't see anybody in it.
It's coming nearer. Wait. Look, it's swinging round. Oh. Looks empty.
This just gets better. Private beach, glass of wine, and now free boat. What's not to like?
Luce, for goodness sake, it's not one of those plastic hire things. It's wood and low in the water. The current's bringing it straight here.
Right, shoes off. Let's pull it in. Ah, it's freezing.
Oh, I've got this side.
Oh, good grief. There's a man! A body! A body? Dead?
How would I know, Luce? You're the nurse.
He looks in a state, soaking wet, scruffy.
Perhaps he's a migrant, someone on the run.
Oh yeah, or an escaped psychopath with a bait box and a keep net. Looks like he's been fishing to me. Come on, hold the boat steady so I can find a pulse. Gosh, it's very fast. He might be in a diabetic coma. He's very cold. Pull the boat up more. Oh, hello? Hello? Quick, Tarn, fetch that carton of orange juice, just in case he comes round. After that rain, he's probably hypothermic. We have got to keep him warm.
I'll get the sleeping bags as well. Now, what can I do? Should we lift him out?
No, he's too heavy in this wet gear. Lift his feet so we can fit his legs in one bag. Careful. Pull it up as much as you can. Unzip the other one and I'll cover him with that. You phone for a doctor.
I've not got much signal. What's their number? 111? 112? 211? Something like that. But I couldn't tell them where we are anyway. I'll drive back to the village for help. It'll be quicker. Back as soon as I can. Right at last. I didn't think it was this far. Oh, thank goodness, the bar's open. And a police car. And the gendarme outside. Bonjour, monsieur.
Bonjour, mademoiselle. Vous avez un rendez-vous avec Lewis Hamilton?
Oui. Non, excusez-moi, monsieur. Say, an emergency.
Emergent? Ah, urgence. Vous êtes anglaise?
Yes. I mean, oui, I'm English. Nous avons un problème.
I speak the English. Tell me.
Please help me. We need a doctor. We found a body in the river. Well, a man, unconscious, in a boat. At a campsite, my friend's looking after him.
Campsite? There is no. Ah, la Gion, camping municipal. But is it shorter?
No, yes, oui. That's where we are. Nous sommes là. We found a man, un homme, in a boat. My friend's a nurse. She's looking after him, but we need a doctor, an ambulance. Quickly, please help.
Of course, mademoiselle. Un moment. I call a pompier. Our fire people, they are medic men. Oui, Jean-Louis. Urgence! Les ours sont camping. Un homme dans la rivière. Oui, tout de suite. Okay, mademoiselle. They will come quick. We go now.
Oh, thank you, thank you.
Allez, allez!
That was a shock then. Hope that guy's gonna be alright. Good job he came around and I got some sugar into him.
I guess we'll find out the gendarmerie tomorrow. But so brilliant you knew what to do. That policeman, he seemed very laid back about the whole thing, I must say. And about staying here.
Pity they made such a mess dragging the boat out and moving vehicles around. We could have had a swim now, but I don't fancy wading through all this mud.
We're covered in it already. Well, come on, it's cleaner there by the pebbles.
Oh, my toe! You all right?
I just didn't swing sharp. It feels like glass or metal.
Good grief!
What? It's a ring. Gold. I'll wash the dirt off. Looks ancient. It's very worn.
Look at that diamond. Somebody would have been gutted to lose that. But you could call it payment for a good deed.
What? Do you think it fell out the boat?
Of course not. Look at the mud in that setting. It's probably been buried here for years. I guess it's yours now. Finders keepers.
Losers weepers. Wonder who lost it.
Cheer up. Look on the bright side. If that huge rock is a diamond, you can pay off your student debt. Maybe help out your best friend, the impoverished nurse.
Mom, I'm back.
Hello, love. Did you have a lovely time? I've missed you. How did Lucy cope with camping?
It was fine, Mum.
Great, lots of sun. We found a gorgeous place by the river opposite some cliffs, and we rescued someone from the water. Lucy knew what to do, and we probably saved his life. And you know, the river had the same name as me. Oh, Mum, it was amazing. And you'll never believe what I...
Oh, it sucks.
Are you all right? Don't cry, I'm back now.
No, I mean, your dad and I had some wonderful times camping by the River Tarn. The gorges were so beautiful at sunset. But that was before you were born. Our honeymoon.
Oh, Mum.
I expect it's very busy nowadays.
Well, not everywhere. This wild place was near a village called Llanaque. It was closed up, really, but they let us stay. And after the
Llanaque? By the River Tarn? But that's where... Well, that's why we called you your name.
You never said. I just thought I had a weird name. And I got teased at school.
It was the best of times for us. We were young, we had no money, but we were together.
Don't cry about happy memories, Mum. You'll make me start. But I've got something to...
No, it's just Llanaque. It brings it all back. I felt so guilty. I thought about it for years, but I never said.
Said what?
Oh, it doesn't matter now. But I lost something there. We were swimming in the river and I lost my engagement ring. Well, your father's grandmother's engagement ring, really. Your dad gave it to me. He was going to have it made smaller, but I wanted to wear it straight away. It was such a lovely diamond, and your dad never complained when I lost it. He never blamed me.
I don't believe this.
It's quite true.
But Mum, I've been trying to tell you. Just let me get it out.
Where did you get that? Can I see?
Of course, try it on.
It fits. My fingers are fatter now, but...
You don't mean it's yours, do you? I found it in the mud churned up by a boat of this man we rescued.
Oh yes, this is definitely my ring. The colours in the stone, the setting, and where it's worn so thin because your great-grandmother wore it all her life. I always felt so guilty about losing it. It's a bit like having your dad back.
Oh, Mum, I don't know what to say. Lucy said finders keepers. She thought I could sell it to pay off my student debt. I couldn't do that now. Now it's come home to you. After all this time.
In Finders Keepers by Patricia Camish. Tom was played by Annie Petchy. Lucy by Lila Judge. The French Policeman by Connor Taylor. And Mum by Wendy Allnut. Sound and editing by Marius Smits and Reese Slyfield. Assisted by Nathan Rove and Alba Sarikovac. Directed by Wendy Allnut. In conjunction with Richmond upon Thames College.
Well, thank you very much. That was lovely. And I love the original French bird song and everything else that went with that. One of the other things that makes radio plays so very, very difficult are just those sorts of things. So much of the storytelling is through sound. The pictures have to be made with dialogue and sounds. So I want everyone to appreciate the skill that's involved in writing radio drama. Our next person is going to be Annie Morris, and she is going to tell us about her play.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here in this event, and I wouldn't be here without their friendship and support and insight of many others. So, not least the feedback that helped me shape the final version of the play, but especially the brilliant cast and technical wizard who brought it to life with this recording. And I have to thank them all first. You can tell I'm not used to this. So to the play, if you can take yourself back 10 years or so, or for those who like to be precise about such things, 9 years, 9 months and 13 days, It's the morning of the 25th of January, 2012, in London, and two 30-something sisters are meeting up in a coffee shop before going on to an exhibition at the V&A. Like many sisters, while they have much in common, they're very different in nature. So Lydia is a dreamer. She's a talented weaver and tapestry artist. Penny, the older sister by just a few years, is neurotic and a highly skilled needlewoman. At the heart of the play is Lydia's passion for Greek mythology, her obsession with one myth in particular, and a recent discovery coincidentally shared by her and Penny. In the sisters' interactions over coffee and at the exhibition, we see the ebb and flow of their relationship, but their meeting is also a coming together of opposites, like when sea meets land and a shoreline is created, a place that holds qualities of both and of neither, a transitional space, if you will. I've talked enough now. Hopefully the play will now speak for itself. Thank you.
Spinners by Annie Morris. Poor captive lark that twitters free, 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 when the cage door is opened, and it flies into what's but another larger cage, whose bars at first do seem invisible.
I'm beginning to see it, Athena. I'm beginning to see.
Lydia? Lydia?
Oh, sorry, Penny. I was just...
Are you all right?
Yeah, sorry. What were you saying?
I was telling you about the arrangements.
Arrangements?
For Sunday. Are you sure you're all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. Carry on.
Well, everything's organised. I'm picking them up at 12 as usual, and they don't suspect a thing. At least, I hope not. You haven't breathed a word, have you, Lydia?
Of course not.
Only Mum told me you finally got round to phoning her last week. Are you sure you didn't drop any hints?
No. I mean, yes, I'm sure.
You're even more distracted than usual. What's wrong?
Well, nothing. So, is everything arranged for Sunday, then? What time are you picking them up?
Lydia, I'm doing my best here.
What?
You haven't heard a word, have you?
Oh, I have. I was just thinking about something. Do you remember that tapestry competition?
Tapestry competition? Lydia, we're in the middle of talking about Sunday. This is important.
Yeah, sorry. But you know how it is when you can't get something out of your head.
For God's sake, Lydia... You shouldn't still be having these childish daydreams.
Penny, I don't think you understand.
I think I do. I know Mum used to find your episodes endearing. You were her favourite, after all. I didn't. Not then, and certainly not now.
I don't know where all that came from, but I'm glad this is one of your laid-back days. Look, I'm sorry, okay?
There's no need for sarcasm. And please stop saying sorry. It's irritating and means nothing when you keep repeating it.
Look, something occurred to me. You know, one of those aha moments. It happens to people.
Why can't you think and have a conversation at the same time? We can't talk for 2 minutes without you going off into one of your flights of fancy.
Oh, you're such an exaggerator. And they're not flights of fancy.
They are in my book. Self-indulgent daydreams. You're always losing track of time with something or other. You'll lose yourself one of these days.
Oh, Penny, please don't start. I know I'm a bit preoccupied, but we haven't seen each other in ages. I don't want to argue. It is my birthday, after all.
Yes, of course. I don't want to argue either. I'm just a bit worried about things.
Oh, well, you're always worried about something.
Well, one of us has to be.
What is it?
At the moment, you.
Me?
Call it a sisterly warning.
What do you mean?
One of these days you'll go so far you won't be able to get back.
We're talking in riddles. That's my province, so you're always telling me. Is Ollie okay? And the twins?
They're fine. Just don't be late on Sunday, Lydia, please. I don't want anything to spoil Mum and Dad's day. 40 years is a big deal.
I'll be there, don't worry, I promise.
Right.
What does that mean?
Does my wedding day ring any bells?
You know how bad I felt about that. I wasn't really that late.
Maids of honour are not late for weddings. Neither are godmothers late for christenings. That's what it says in my rule book. God knows what it says in yours.
Well, I think I lost mine a while back, don't you?
I'm not sure you ever had one.
You do remember the competition, don't you?
Vaguely. We were just teenagers.
But it took over our lives, didn't it? Well, it did mine. I've had a bit of a thing about it ever since.
Why bring it up now?
Because it's all connected, you see. And with the Spider Silk exhibition opening on my birthday, well, I just knew we were meant to be here today.
You and your meant to be's. What is it about this competition then?
I wanted you to know that I don't mind now.
Don't mind what?
Well, that you won it.
Lydia, it was over 20 years ago.
I know, but I needed to tell you. I...
Go on.
I was devastated. I put the whole of my inadequate little self into it. It wasn't just one of those teenage things, you know. I really did think the sky had fallen in.
I never realised.
I hid it. From you. Well, from everybody. Well, I'd hoped I did. The point is, it went against the myth, don't you see?
All I remember is we had to portray a scene from mythology.
You mean you've forgotten Arachne?
Sorry, Lydia, there are so many myths, so many versions, they just don't stick with me.
Arachne boasts her weaving skills are better than Athena's. Remember, she challenges the goddess to a contest.
Oh, yes. Doesn't it all get a bit grim in the end?
More than a bit. Athena's outraged. She can't find fault with Arachne's work and she destroys it. Arachne tries to hang herself, but Athena turns her into a spider instead.
God, it is grim. I remember now, you wanted us to mirror the tapestries. I did the gods of Olympus on their thrones. You did Zeus's misdemeanors, right?
I knew you hadn't forgotten.
And you ranted on about cosmic opposites, chaos versus order, artist against authority, that sort of thing. You drove us all mad with it.
Did I really? I must have been a nightmare.
You were, at times.
I had the imagination, Penny, but you had the skill. I wish you'd use it these days. You know what they say?
That's a ridiculously overused phrase. Some things you never lose. They become part of you.
But one's no good without the other, is it? Nothing really special gets created without imagination and skill.
I'm not sure. Maybe. What are you getting at?
I've just discovered a play of Arachne, written in the 20s. It's absolutely charming. And the ending is amazing. It's a Greek myth with a happy ending. How brilliant is that?
Can't believe I'm saying this. Do you mean the Adelaide Eden Philpott play?
You know it.
Ollie gave me a first edition last week. He picked it up on one of his trips, LA of all places.
And you didn't tell me?
Was I supposed to? I'm not a mind reader.
Well, why did he get it? It's not exactly your sort of thing.
The illustrations. Decorations, I should say. He thought they'd be useful. Typical 1920s, you see, and I'm going to be working soon on something similar, an embroidery.
Wonderful.
That he found it, or that I'm getting back to embroidery.
Or both. I'm so pleased for you. I didn't know you were even thinking of going back.
You're right. It's been too long. But now the twins are at school, I've got some proper time to myself.
You were the best, Penny. I couldn't do half of what I do without the things you taught me. I owe you a lot.
I don't know about that.
No, I mean it. It was your skill that made things happen. And your patience. I still struggle with that one.
Oh, thank you. It's nice to hear. Everyone likes to be appreciated sometimes.
But isn't it incredible we both found the play?
I've been so immersed in the decorations, the title completely slipped my mind until you mentioned it. Spooky, eh?
A synchronistic gift from the gods.
Trust you to say something like that.
And it's a brilliant play, isn't it?
It's been so hectic lately, I haven't actually read it.
Oh, you must.
I will. Right now, my focus has to be those decorations. Striking, but simple. Just what I'm after.
There's a fabulous part where Arachne creates a rainbow scarf. But as I said, the ending is amazing.
I haven't read it, remember?
Well, Arachne still becomes a spider, but not forever. Only for a year, so she can learn the real skill of spinning. So no tragic end, it all fits. Don't you see?
Well, Lydia, I know this means a lot to you, but sometimes we seem to speak different languages.
Oh, look at the time, we've got to go. At least the V&A is only around the corner. I'm so looking forward to this.
Me too.
Right, come on.
That's better. I hate January. It's a roar out there.
But don't you love the winter hugs you get coming into places like this? Golden spider silk. This is it.
What a huge glass case. I didn't think it would be so big.
Gosh, yes. And there's already a small crowd. We've got to get to the front. Follow me.
Not so fast, Lydia.
Oh, it's magnificent.
Stunning.
It looks like solid gold. But you can almost see right through it as well. How did they do that?
Look at the stitching. It's perfect. Exquisite.
Look at the weave. It's faultless. Divine. Wow, it says here spider silk hasn't been woven for over a century.
God, the work that's gone into this.
And it says here the cape took years to make. Over 1 million golden orb spiders gave their silk. Milked for their silk, Penny. Isn't that a fabulous phrase?
Yes, but I can read, you know.
Oh, sorry, I'm just so excited. I thought golden silk was only in fairy tales. And apparently you can't feel spider silk. It's like wearing an invisibility cloak. Imagine working with it, Penny. Weaving it. Gosh, imagine being a spider spinning it.
I'll stick to working with it, thank you.
I think it would be an incredible experience.
You would.
But wouldn't it be brilliant to create something like this? Something special? The two of us, working together, I mean. I'd really, really like that.
I would too.
I'm so pleased you said that.
Not right now, of course. I'll be busy with this new project.
That's okay. There's work I have to do first. Something to look forward to, though.
Yes.
Oh, Penny, look at the cape. It's like it's almost alive.
Well, I wouldn't say that. But I think I know what you're trying to say.
Can't take my eyes off it. Madagascar is a strange place, isn't it? To have golden spiders, I mean. I must go there.
Can we just focus on the exhibits for a few minutes, Lydia? Without talking?
I wish these people weren't here. I need to get closer. This glass is just in the way. I keep seeing my own reflection. I need to get closer. Follow every thread from beginning to end. That's what Arachne would have done. I need to get closer.
Maiden, farewell. In thy new form appear. Transformed thus, O little one, remain through summer, autumn, winter, till the spring revive, when I will give thee back again thy maiden's form, and thou, awakening, shalt smile upon me, and all this shall seem but as a dream.
You know, Lydia, I see what you mean now. It's taken on a different texture. It seems, well, alive, I suppose. God, I'm beginning to sound like you.
Excuse me?
I'm so sorry. I thought you were my sister. She was here a moment ago.
Well, I've been here a while.
But she was standing right where you are.
Well, she must have wandered off. Go ask the guy in the uniform over there.
Yes, I will, thank you. God, Lydia, where have you got to now? Excuse me, did you just see a woman leave?
No, madam.
Dark hair, black coat, long multicoloured scarf.
No, madam.
Is there another way out?
No, madam.
She might have been in a bit of a daze. Are you absolutely sure?
Yes, madam. No one's left this room in the last 10 minutes.
God. Lydia. No. No!
In Spinners by Annie Morris, Lydia was played by Kate Varr, and Penny was played by Leah O'Grady. It was recorded by Tobias Withers.
Well, that certainly gave me goosebumps. One of the great things about being able to do this radio play competition is that, again, it is in memory of Colin Skipp, who played Tony Archer for so very many years with the BBC, and his lovely widow, Lisa, who's joining us in a moment, used her good offices with the BBC Writers' Room, and the BBC Writers' Room has given written feedback to each of our finalists, and they will also have a half hour meeting with each of them as well. And I just wanted to take this opportunity to thank Simon Nelson of the BBC Writers' Room for taking the time, which he did in honor and in memory of Colin Skipp and at the behest of his wife, Lisa. Now we're going to listen to our last offering now. They always say best for last, Carolyn. The best for last. This is Carolyn Pertwee, and she's going to tell us about her play.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm not going to really tell you about my play because I don't want to give away the plot. I was given a word, and it was this word that inspired me to write this short play. I write quite a lot of short plays. Started writing as a child and born into a theatrical family, and made my stage debut age 12 in Dear Brutus by J.M. Barrie. And I'm still acting, but I took up writing in my middle years. So this play, we got together in my house with the help of Amanda Barrie, who produced and directed it and is in the play as well, and two lovely actors, Edmund Dane and Isabella Inchbold. And we made a little hut in my study, and they were both of them quite tall and big, and it was just amazing. I think if there were children there, they would have absolutely loved to have gone inside it. Anyway, the play is called Heart to Heart, and I'm not telling you the word because that might give away the plot. Thank you.
Heart to Heart by Cllr Pertwee. The play takes place in Zachary Green's house, and the time is the present day.
Green?
But he not here. You have appointment?
Yes, he... Excuse me. Sorry, I need my buffer.
You okay? You want I fetch water?
No, I'm fine now, thanks. That hill is so steep. I walked up from the station.
You say you have appointment? He not tell me?
No? Well, you must have forgotten then. It's very important that I see him. I've come all the way from London. How long will he be?
He gone to shop, so not long, I think.
Please, can I come in and sit down?
He tell me no visitors.
What's your name?
My name, it is Arga.
I promise you, Arga, he will want to see me, but I do need to sit down. Please.
Okay, I take you to study. This way, please.
Wow, what an interesting room, so many books.
He do all his works here. He is, how you say, an alcoholic worker.
I think you mean a workaholic.
Oh, yes, my English, sorry. I empty ashtrays. The smell. I clean room later. You want coffee?
No, thanks, I'm fine. I might shut my eyes for a minute. Please, don't let me hold you up any longer.
Okay. Excuse vacuum noise.
Arga, I'm home. Arga, I'm... Sod it, I need a drink. Ah, that's better.
Excuse me, I don't want
Who
to...
Who the hell are you?
So sorry, I didn't mean to give you a fright.
Well, you did. I don't know you, do I?
Well, you do and you don't.
What's that supposed to mean? Oh, Christ, you're not from HMRC, are you? I know I've fallen behind, but I did write
to you. Nothing like that.
Did my cleaner let you in?
Yes, I told her you were expecting me.
But I'm not, so you lied.
Well, sort of, yes.
Are you a journalist? If you are, I'll show you out. I've told my agent strictly no interviews.
No, I'm not a journalist. This is not easy, but I understand you're still grieving, but...
Ah, you're the bereavement counsellor from Cruise. Look, as I said on the phone, I would call you if I needed any counselling. I have to sort things out for myself. No one else can do it.
No, I'm not a bereavement counsellor from Cruise, though I fully recommend them. Mum and I went when my dad died unexpectedly. They really helped us.
I'm sorry about your dad. Look, young lady, why are you here? Are you a fan? I'll give you an autograph, sign a book if that's what you want, but then you must go.
No, thanks. I don't read science fiction. Sorry. I'll try and explain. Please don't be angry. Your wife compelled me to come here.
My wife. My wife is dead. You've no right to be here. I want you to leave immediately.
I know she's dead, but she's been invading my space. She told me to come here.
Why would my wife speak to you? She doesn't know you.
Oh, but she does. I'm here because... You gave me her heart. She gave me my life. It's beating here, inside me.
Why didn't you say?
We were told not to contact you under any circumstances. You wanted to remain anonymous. I thought if I told you who I was, you'd sling me out.
I still may. How did you find out?
One of the nurses let slip to another nurse while they were checking my stats. They thought I was asleep. She'd read all your books. My boyfriend did some research and found out where you lived. It wasn't difficult.
Did your boyfriend bring you here?
He wanted to, but I had to do this on my own.
Why didn't you respect my wishes? I would have thought, in the circumstances, that's the very least you could have done.
I had to. She left me no choice. She's starting to take over my life, and I want her to stop. I need to move on now, and so do you, and so does she.
I don't believe in an afterlife and all that stuff. This is a figment of your imagination.
She's not in the afterlife. That's the problem. She's still trapped inside me.
What utter poppycock! Sorry, my dear. You shouldn't have said that. It was unjustified. Look, you've been through probably the most invasive surgery known to man, a heart replacement. It has obviously affected your mind. Not surprising. But I think you might need some psychiatric help.
Please don't patronise me. I already see a psychiatrist.
Ah. Good. Good.
No. That doesn't explain it. I watched myself dying during the operation. I heard the surgeon saying, I think we've lost her.
Where were you?
I was floating above my body. As they appeared to be stuffing raw, pulsating meat inside an open cavity in my chest. I wasn't frightened. I was suddenly released. No pain, free, light as air. And then I turned and went along a tunnel towards the most glorious light. No words can describe it, or the feeling of complete happiness that enveloped me. And there, standing in the glow at the end of the tunnel, with his arms outstretched, was my dad, but I felt myself being dragged back. I reached out to him. Then there was a loud bang and a beating sound in my ear, everything pounding and pulsating, and then it went black. Next thing I knew, there were all these people in green overalls and masks standing over me.
That must have been an extraordinary experience. What's your name? The hospital never said. Just that you were young and in urgent need of surgery.
It's Dido.
Dido and Aeneas?
Yes. My dad was half Greek.
What did your psychiatrist have to say about your experience?
He doesn't say much. He lets me talk. I've had very bad post-operative depression. I was told I had the heart of a 42-year-old woman who was in a head-on collision with a lorry.
That's right. Natalia. My wife.
Mum told me they had to ask your permission to take her heart because there was no hope. She was brain dead.
Yes. They kept her going on a life support till I got there. Would you like a whiskey?
No, thanks.
Pour a cup of tea. I can ask Argo, though I don't recommend her tea.
Honestly, I'm fine, thanks. She wants you to stop doing that.
Who? Doing what?
Natalia. Drinking. She says you're killing yourself.
Please. I can't go along with all this spiritual mumbo-jumbo, sorry.
It's not mumbo-jumbo, it is her. She calls you Zacco. To be honest, I did wonder sometimes if it was all in my mind, you know, with all the medication I'm on, but once I saw all those photographs on your desk, I knew it was her.
Zacco? She used to call me that when she wanted something. And does she come to you in your dreams?
She's in my head most of the time. She comforts me. She tells me her death hasn't been wasted as she's given me life. You see, I felt so guilty. I felt I had no right to be happy at the expense of her life and yours.
There, there. It was very brave of you to come. I'd so love to believe it was her.
It is, Zachary. She says you have to stop living those last moments. You made the right decision.
She said that. I didn't know what to do. We'd never discussed death or what we felt about being donors. We neither of us even gave blood. We'd lived in our own cocoon of happiness. I went in to see her. Her face was unrecognizable. When they asked me for her heart, I couldn't bear the thought of them ripping open her body. I wanted to ask her what I should do. It was all so unreal. Only a few hours before, we'd been lying in each other's arms. And then I heard myself saying yes to the surgeon. He was very persuasive. I signed the forms and left. It's been eating me alive ever since.
I knew that because you wouldn't allow us to thank you. I felt your anguish. I am thanking you now, though, if I may, with all her heart.
I'm really glad you found me. So now, I can thank you for making it all worthwhile.
You have been listening to Heart to Heart by Cllr Pertwee. Arga was played by Amanda Bailey, Dido by Isabella Inchbald, and Zachary by Edmund Dane. Music was by Vortex, and the sound by Ellen Kruger. This is a Hog in the Limelight production, directed by Amanda Bailey, for Arts Richmond New Radio Play Competition 2021.
As you can see, it was a very, very difficult decision. We had over 40 submissions for this particular competition, which really was much more than we had anticipated getting. So it was very difficult to get down to these terrific last four. But of course, all of this is in memory of Colin Skipp, and I'm very, very pleased and proud to be able to invite Lisa, his widow, up to tell us a bit more about Colin.
Okay.
And it's better than a bench.
Yeah. Definitely. I'm sorry, folks, but as most people aren't wearing masks, I'm going to keep mine on and just hope you can hear me all right.
Good diction, Lisa.
Any problem if you can't, let me know. Also, sorry for the notes. I could probably stand here and talk about my husband for about 6 hours, but it's either getting old or living through a pandemic that I find that I think thoughts, and if I don't write them down, they vanish up into the ether. So, if Colin is looking down on us, as I believe he is, he will be amazed. Amazed that you think he's worthy of this tribute. He was a lovely man, a gentleman in every way, kind and considerate to others and always willing to help anyone. He was also very modest, and had no idea what a very talented actor he was. After he died, I received so many cards and letters, all saying how much they liked him and what a great actor he was, and not just from his friends, but also from the controller of BBC Radio 4. I tried many times to persuade him to write his autobiography. He had such a fund of stories, many of them connected with the Archers, and he loved to tell them. On one occasion, he'd been asked to open a church fete somewhere out in the countryside, and he was a little bit late getting there. And this was very unusual for Colin because he was very prompt. If he was going for a train, he'd arrive at the station in time to catch the train before the one he wanted. So it was very unusual for him to be late, but he was, and he was there just in time for them to usher him up onto the platform and sit him next to the vicar's wife, who obviously hadn't been primed very well about who was opening the fete that day, because just before he was going to stand up, she turned to him and said, "What's everyone talking about the Archers for? I can't stand that programme, can you?" I imagine Colin would have just smiled at her. Despite the fact that he wouldn't write himself, Colin had great admiration for people who did. He loved the fact that someone could be faced with a blank sheet of paper
and then out of their head produced something wonderful. So we would have had great admiration for our finalists. This competition is such a brilliant way to commemorate him. And I want to thank Nancy for coming up with the idea, making it possible, and putting in so much hard work to make it a success. Also, Simon Nelson from the BBC for offering his expertise and words of wisdom to our four finalists. I know he must be a very busy man, and we're very grateful for his time. I also want to thank everyone who entered the competition, especially our four finalists for submitting such excellent short radio plays. I read the final four and enjoyed them immensely. I'm so pleased I didn't have to decide on a winner, as it must have been an extremely difficult job. They're all so good. My husband's memory is in my heart forever, and our daughter Nova and granddaughter Melody, both of whom he loved so much, talk with me about him every day. So it's lovely to see his name on the trophy. I hope it will inspire the winner to keep writing so that we can all watch, read, or listen to their work in the future. And now I'll hand over to Buffy, I think, who's going to announce the winner.
Buffy is going to announce the winner as soon as I tell her who it is.
Yes.
Sorry. You're handing the cup.
Yes.
Well, so much for stage management. In the brown envelope.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, ma'am.
You just pull that out. What's in the brown envelope? While we're waiting, while you're pulling that up.
Certainly, I'll call it.
I'm just going to give you all your feedback. And the contact number, don't share it too widely, for Simon Nelson and Fanny. And the winner is?
You hold the cup.
Oh, yeah, I'm holding the cup.
And the winner is, I'm not going to do one of those scary things they do on TV, but the winner is Anna Burns.
Congratulations. Would you like to say a few words, and then we're going to get all the finalists up so we can get a nice photograph with the mayor and with Sir Vince, and not with me. Please, go ahead.
I'm a bit lost for words. Thank you so much. It's been brilliant this past hour or so listening to all your works, and I'm honoured that it's a competition, it's me, but I really enjoyed doing this. Thank you so much, Arts Richmond, the Skipp family, everyone in this room for providing such an exciting and enjoyable opportunity for writers and radio lovers. And I just quickly want to thank all the people involved, Harriet Onyet, my leading lady, James Trapmore, Rob Layton, and also my niece, my son, and my nephew for getting involved in the play. Someone once said to me, what would you do if you won the lottery? How would you spend your time? And I said, writing scripts. So I feel like I've kind of won the lottery today. Thank you very much.
Could all my finalists please come up and have your picture taken with Anna and with the mayor?
Sure.
I know you're worried about no
time. Enjoy them all. They're all very good. Couple of guys.
Yes, and we're going to let Andrew take one as well.
They're there, over there.
Andrew could as well. Put it on our social media. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Can I just thank the mayor again for allowing us to please use this lovely room and for coming and making it special. Would you like to say a few final words and sign us off?
Well, I would, yes. It's been a great afternoon. I think the plays are amazing, all of you, actually. And I presume we're going to carry on, Nancy, doing this every year now, is that
well,
right?
Well, every other year.
Every other year, okay. A lot of work's gone into it, and it's great to see that we've finally been able to do it, because letting me out and about now, although I'm at home here, but nevertheless, it's good to do it. So thank you all again for coming. You're welcome here anytime, and good luck for the future. I hope to see you all around at Arts Richmond events in the future, not too distant future. So hopefully you'll ask me again.
Always.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And that is the end of our live stream, because we're going to now have a little tea and say hi and everything else. So goodbye and thank you. Lisa, would you like to come and have your picture?